In the last video, we built our own K-means class. In this one, we're going to be learning about how the one that comes with sklearn works. And usually you'll want to do that because it works, it kind of gets all these tricky details right. For example, you can easily have it automatically generate varying numbers of starting clusters. It will often have strategies that are smarter than pure randomness for choosing the positions of those. Before it runs the algorithm, it generally has some logic around when it has been updating the centers enough and it's not going to get any better. And so you can set an upper cap on that, but it's not going to do it more than necessary in general. So overall, you're going to want to use k-means that comes with sklearn rather than rolling your own. So the k-means actually has these three methods with it that we need to know. We have fit, which is not surprising, right? We've seen fit for both transformers and estimators. What's a little bit strange about it is that it has both transform, like you might expect for a transformer, and predict, like you might expect for an estimator. So k-means has some similarities with both transformers and estimators, even though estimators and prediction is a little bit, it's kind of a strange use of it, right? Because we aren't predicting some label that was given to us. We're both coming up with the labels and predicting them at the same time, so it's not really a classic prediction. So I'm going to just show some rough code or kind of data to demonstrate what these three are doing in the context of the code we wrote before we actually dive into using k-means. So before in our class, we saw that we had these assign points and update center, and that was the real core of what we needed to do. And a fit method, what it'll probably be doing is some sort of loop like this for I in range of something. It's just going to be calling both of those. It'll call the assign points, and it will call the update centers, and it'll do that a bunch of times to try to find the right answer. And how many times is that? Well, we're going to call that number of times it does that, the number of epochs, right? And so I'm going to say epochs here. And like I was saying, right, in the actual k-means that comes with sklearn, this will be an upper bound, right? If it sees that this is not improving anything further, it might have some break that happens if it's already done. If not getting any better. I'm not trying to do that. I'm just trying to write kind of rough code to give you an idea of what's happening. And so when we do this, right, on our version, I plot this at the end, hopefully it's solving this and kind of updating those points. And indeed it is, right? It's kind of figuring out where each of those centroids should go. So that's the fit method. Now, in the process of doing this, we created a lot of supplemental information for our original data frame, right? So this was our original data frame that just has some points. And in contrast to that, we have this data frame that the k-means class was using with some extra information. First, we have the distance to each of the clusters, and so that can be useful information in and of itself, but looking at those three distances, we can figure out which number is smallest. In this case, number in the x column is smallest, so this is going to be, this row is going to be in the x cluster, right? In this next one, the O number is smallest, so we're going to be in the O cluster. And so when we're looking at, let me actually just shorten this up a bit. When we're looking at using k-means for either transformation or prediction, the only difference is whether we're using these distances or the labels. And so let me do the transformation first, or just show you what we'll get there. We'll be effectively getting this data. That's what we'll get out when we do a transformation in k-means, and I'll eventually talk about how that's useful as a pre-processing step before we do something like logistic regression. And then for prediction, all we're really getting is, well, what group does it fit nicely into? And again, right, this is not really like classic prediction because we're both deciding what the labels are and deciding which points go with each label. Okay, I'm going to use k-means on this same data from k-means from sklearn this time instead of our own. And so I'm going to say km equals k-means. And there's a bunch of configuration options here. For example, how many clusters we want to start with. I'm going to say we would like to start with three of them, and then what? We can say km.fet. We always have to do a fet regardless of whether we're going to do a transformation or prediction next. And I want to fit that data frame. But let me just look at that one more time. Data frame dot head. So I want to fit that data, and we do. And once we do that, then we can do either of those things. We could say transform, and there might be some cases where this is a kind of a training data, and then we're trying to apply our clusters or force our clusters on some, you know, second data frame, maybe some test data. And it'll be very common, though, that we want to do it to the same original data. And so when I'm doing this transformation here, I saw, well, I have three clusters, and that's why I'm getting three columns of numbers here, right? The three distances for each row in my original data set. And it's very common, right? Rather than doing fit and then transform, you know, why not do both at once, just like so? That would be a fine thing to do. The same way, I can also do a fit predict, and then instead of saying, well, which group is it in, it's trying to tell me specifically, oh, you're in group zero, you're in group two, so on and so forth. And so something we might want to do, right, is that I might want to create a copy of my original data frame and then add this prediction in. And I'm going to say, what am I going to say? I'm going to call that cluster, right? I could call it a classification, something like that. And let me actually look at this now. Right, I can see, well, these are the clusters that it's predicted to be in. Maybe I'll look at the tail to see some others, right? And so I could plot it, and I could assign different colors to the different clusters if I wanted to, right? I could say dot plot dot scatter x equals x0, y equals x1, right? We're having x along both dimensions. You get those three things. But I'd really like to see what color they are, so I'm going to pass in color equals data frame 2 of what cluster you are, and you notice one of these vanishes, so 0 ends up being white. And so what I should do is I should pass in a different color map. And so let me head over here and look at the different color maps in matplotlib. Cluster 0 is not more similar to cluster 1 than it is to cluster 2, right? So I don't really care about getting what is called a sequential color map, something like that, where it's kind of on the spectrum. Really, 0, 1, and 2 are just different categories for me. So I'm going to be looking into the qualitative color maps, and I'm just trying to go with this one here because it's a nice set of colors, and I'm not trying to have more than 10 clusters. I'm going to do that. I'm going to say I want the tab 10 color map. And now I can see it's actually giving those different colors, those different groups of points. If I wanted to, I could also look at the centroids and draw that on top of here. And I get the centroids like so. I can say k-means dot cluster centers. And what am I getting here? Well, the coordinates of each centroid are like a row here, and I have three centroids, and that's why I have three rows. And so I could absolutely wrap that up in a data frame, and I could plot it, right? I could say dot plot dot scatter, and I could say, well, the x is x0, x is 0, y is 1, and I could plot those three points. And let me just make them larger and red, right? So I'm going to say color equals red, size equals 100. Actually, use S here. And I should really combine this with what I had before. I can actually see the centroids. And to really make it work, I have to say that it should use the same region, right? So, you know, let me just split this up here, right? It's getting too long. Centroids, dot, plot, dot, scatter, same AX. And so I can do all that same stuff, just like I did with our own version version before. Okay, let me address an issue, which is, how did I know that we should use three clusters? And, well, the answer here is that I just kind of eyeballed it. What if there's like 20 clusters, right? That might not be so easy to do. Or what if instead of having nice two-dimensional data, I have x0, x1, x2, x3, x4, x5? It won't be obvious beforehand how many clusters there are. And so the strategy that you'll do is you'll try a different number of clusters and see how well it does. And this measure of how well it does is called inertia. And so I can look at inertia in our data like this. And well, what is this measuring? It's measuring the average squared distance from points to nearest centroid. That's what that means, right? So for example, this one over here is actually kind of far from that centroid, right? So that'll contribute a lot to this score. Whereas this one right here is really close to a centroid, right? So hopefully everything's kind of neatly around a centroid. And of course, the more centroids I have, this number will go down, this inertia number will go down, right? Lower is better, right? It means, well, no, the number means everything's near a centroid. And so what we'll do is we'll actually try different numbers of clusters and see how quickly inertia drops off. So let's do this. So I'm going to go back and kind of grab all of this stuff I had before. And so I'm going to grab this. Let me do this. This is what I really need. I am going to have a little loop like this. And I don't even care about making the predictions anymore. I just want to know that inertia score. I'm going to say inertia. Score. Okay, and so you can see what I'm going to do here, right? I'm going to try different amounts, and of course, as I add more of these things, the inertia goes down until, well, if I have the same number of clusters and points, then luckily each point gets its own cluster. So I'm going to have a loop here. I'm going to say 4k in range, and I want to have 1 to 10 clusters, right? So k, that's why it's k means. K is the number of centroids, and mean versus the fact that a centroid is kind of the average of the other XY values. I run this thing, and I want to put all of these in a dictionary, or better than a dictionary even, a series, right? So I'm going to say scores equals a series. And so I'm going to do it like this. I'm going to say scores of K equals this thing, this inertia. I'm going to try running this, and when I'm all done, or I think there's maybe some issues here still. One of the issues that's actually relatively new in Pandas is that they don't like you to leave it ambiguous what the type is going to be. So I'm going to be very explicit up front. This series is going to have floats. And then the other thing it's complaining about is, well, I have a key error of 1. And the reason why I have that is because when I just put brackets after a series, it's guessing whether this is an index or an integer position. And now it's guessing incorrectly that it's an integer position, right? So it's guessing this, which of course doesn't work. If I change it to that, voila, I can get my scores. And once I have my scores, of course, I can plot my scores like so. And I should also do this. I should say that put some labels here. Well, X label is K, which is the number of clusters. And my Y label is what? My Y label is the average squared distance to your nearest centroid, right? And so when I'm looking at this here, I see that having two centroids is much better than having one, so there's two very clear clusters. Going from 2 to 3, another big improvement. After that, doesn't make sense to have four centroids, right? That's not going to give me much improvement. Let's try running this again, right? I'm going to run it from the top, because sometimes these clusters will tend to overlap each other. So just because, you know, way back here, I created three clusters, doesn't mean there's going to be three clear clusters at the end. So let me just run this again. And here, right, it's not as clear. Is that two clusters or three clusters? And not surprisingly, well, there's less benefit going from two to three. Let me just try running it a couple more times, get some more intuition here. Okay, so that is very clear that we want to go to three. I want to see one where it's really overlapping, but it's kind of a matter of luck here. What about that one? Not so much benefit going from two to three, right? Because these two are overlapping each other so much, right? Okay, so that's what you'll often want to do. So one of the use cases for these things is that you will create a plot like this just so you can say something about your data. You can say how many kind of distinct clusters there are. And that of course, is a matter of prediction. Next time I'm going to be talking about how we can do, where was my notes? What are the uses for these transformations? Why might we want to get data about the distance to each of the clusters?